All right, you guys, we're going to get started. So, my name is Rolinda Moretti, and I would like to introduce the Vice President of Young America's Foundation, Patrick Coyle. Yeah. Pat became involved in campus activism when he was a student at Penn State University. This is when he first joined the Young Americans for Freedom chapter. During his college years, he battled liberal ideology and brought many speakers to campus, becoming the chairman of his chapter. He even organized a protest that was featured on the Rush Limbaugh radio program. Pat was named by Human Events magazine as one of the top 10 young conservative activists in the nation and has been hailed for sending hundreds of high-profile conservative speakers to college campuses across the country. He is also a co-editor of the Conservative Guide to Campus Activism. Pat is responsible for overseeing student programs and creating new activism initiatives and materials. He is also the executive director of Young Americans for Freedom, a project of the Young Americas Foundation. A few of the initiatives he has established are the 9/11 Never Forget Project, No More Che Day, and Freedom Week. I met Pat about 6 years ago at a Young Americans Foundation high school conference in Santa Barbara, California, and have worked with him to promote conservative ideas on different campuses ever since. He has helped me organize the 9/11 Never Forget Project on 3 different campuses and assisted my University of California, San Diego Young Americans for Freedom chapter in hosting speakers such as Ben Shapiro and Ann McElhinney. It is my pleasure to introduce Patrick Coyle.
Thank you. Hey, what's up? How you guys doing? It's been a great conference. Have you had a good time? Awesome. I know you've had a good time. I've been staying in the dorms. So anyhow, it's great to have you all here. Here we are at one of the last sessions of the conference. And again, I hope you've had a great time with us. And it's been great having you here. You've been a great group. But, you know, to me, I think it's always a shame that you have to be at this program, obviously. You know, you shouldn't have to take a full week out of your summer vacation just to learn about conservative ideas. You shouldn't have to, you know, travel from Washington State and California and take red-eye flights just to get to hear this program, to hear the speakers that we have for you. And it's a shame that, you know, the principal, the faculty at your school, the president of your school, really don't feel that they don't have to provide you with a balanced education. So the goal of everyone here at Young America's Foundation this week has been to provide you with that balance, to simply give you the opportunity to learn more about conservative ideas. So this week, instead of hearing from people like, you know, Barack Obama or Michael Moore or Nancy Pelosi, you've been fortunate to be able to hear from people like Ted Cruz and Tim Scott and all these great speakers, Walter Williams. Instead of being forced to learn, you know, obscure subjects like the feminist perspective on Marxist thought or the paradigm of lesbian Eskimos living in Brazil, you've actually been able to learn about the virtues of the free market. And instead of, you know, having to watch your classmates like attack America and attack your ideas, you know, you've actually been surrounded by hundreds of your peers who actually, you know, embrace what you believe in. However, we actually won't consider this conference a success until we see more activism at your schools. And we really hope that this program is a springboard for further activism on your part. Now, I know a lot of the other speakers this week have kind of talked about, you know, what are conservative ideas, what are some conservative policies that we should endorse and follow and encourage. Well, I want to focus my time really on, you know, how can you promote conservatism at your school? You know, what are the strategies, what are the activities that you can organize to take back and make an impact at your school on how all of you can be successful activists on your respective university campuses? And to talk about, you know, what is a successful activist, I think we need to break that down a little bit. I think a successful activist is made up of 3 basic components. One, some will say a successful activist is based off of the number of activities that they hold on campus. So how often is that conservative club out there holding a recruitment table, bringing in a conservative speaker, you know, blogging, tweeting, whatever it may be? Some say, well, the success of an individual club is based on the number of events. Well, I think that's partially true. Others say, well, you can't just have the activism. You actually need to know the ideas behind the activism, and I agree with that. That's why we have programs like this one, so you can learn more about conservatism and conservative ideas. However, I think there's a third component that truly underscores a successful activist, and that is, and it's kind of hinted at on the slide, and that is, what is your activist mentality? In other words, what is the approach? What are the strategies that you are using? What are the ideas that you're using to present your ideas to other students at your school? So, for example, you can have a recruitment table virtually every day on your campus, but if you have materials at that recruitment table that turn people off, or if you are talking about or focusing on topics that just don't resonate, you're not going to be successful with your activism. So I think a true successful activist is based off of their activist mentality, and I'll get to that in a little bit. However, I think I should first take a little bit of time to talk about the reaction that you'll receive if you choose to speak out. Now, I know a number of you are already active in this conference, but I do want to touch on this at least in part. And, you know, you all are, I'm sure, aware of the liberal intolerance that conservatives face on college campuses. And unfortunately, it's gotten worse over the years. In the past, you know, you may have heard these stories where the left has done things like, you know, burn Bibles outside of lecture halls just to show their displeasure about a conservative speaker speaking on campus. When black conservatives have appeared on college campuses like Walter Williams, they've been, the left has often shouted racial slurs at them. You know, instead of the left, you know, God forbid, ever challenging our speakers with thought-provoking questions, we sometimes see leftists resorting to throwing food at them to try and stop the event from happening, throwing bricks through windows, and other sorts of nonsense. You may have also heard the incidents in high schools as well. There was a student who was threatened with arrest just because by his teacher just because he was being critical of Barack Obama. There was also a middle school teacher who basically had his class do opposition research for the Obama campaign. And what is shocking about these incidents is that you never hear a prominent figure on the left say, you know, like Bill Maher or Hillary Clinton or whoever it may be, like, whoa, wait a second, this is wrong. Like, we should not be, you know, attacking these and trying, like, you know, protesting these events, trying to shut them down and so on. We should allow these events to go forward. We shouldn't be stifling speech on campus. Well, that rarely happens. And to really kind of hammer home how the left tries to reinforce its ideas, especially on college campuses, one example I always like to point to is the liberal speaker parade. And again, this is something that occurs on most college campuses. You guys have probably seen it at your schools. And what is the liberal speaker parade? Well, for example, let's look at like Boise State University. This is a school that for over a six-year period spent $300,000 of funds on liberal speakers and $0 on conservatives. At Lehigh University in Pennsylvania, this school over a four-year period spent $215,000 on liberal speakers and only $25,000 on conservatives. At Syracuse University, a bunch of students did some research there, some conservatives, and what they found is that since 2003, the school has brought in 13 liberal speakers to only one conservative. And this school, George Washington University, they advertise their own liberal speaker parade right outside this building. You can go right out to the front of this building and look at their own little liberal speaker parade. They're proud that of the 12 speakers featured, they have one conservative, Clarence Thomas. He's a great speaker. But all the rest of them are liberals or who knows. And that's the strange thing about the left. They always think, oh, we have our one conservative that'll balance out like the thousands of liberal speakers that we bring to speak at our school. But what's worse than the liberal speaker parade, though, is how and when administrators at all of your schools, potentially, maybe except Hillsdale and Liberty and others, that really basically go out of their way to just try and stop your events from happening. Now, there's a number of examples I can point to. I know some of you in here have faced your own situations with leftist administrators. But one example I like to focus on is one that occurred last spring at a high school. And it happened at Grosse Pointe South High School outside of Detroit, Michigan. And we were working with our YAF chapter there, and they wanted to bring in a speaker. And so their leadership got together, and they decided that they wanted to host Rick Santorum to speak at their high school. And they did what they had to do. They went and did the proper thing. They went to the principal of the school, and they got the principal's permission to have the event, to have Rick Santorum come in, speak to a full school assembly on the topic of leadership. And the principal signed off on it, and we're like, great, this is going to be awesome. This is fantastic. We didn't think we would even get that far, so we were pretty happy about it. And so we went forward with it. We started advertising. And once the YAF chapter at that school started announcing that Rick Santorum was going to speak in front of a full school assembly, you know, the entire high school, the whole community just went nuts, especially the teachers. I mean, they just could not handle the fact that, oh, my gosh, here comes Rick Santorum to talk to our students about leadership. It's, like, unheard of. Like, how could this be happening? And I always thought that this reaction to Rick Santorum was, you know, kind of strange. I mean, here's a guy who, you know, was a United States senator. He speaks a lot on campuses for Young America's Foundation. When he goes to campuses, like at Yale University, he had like 1,700 students turn out to hear him speak. He's a best-selling author. So why shouldn't students at this high school hear from this guy? Well, the controversy that came about by all these teachers being against the event made its way to the superintendent of the district. And the superintendent gave me a call one day and basically said, we are not going to have Rick Santorum speak at our school. He is extreme. He is for traditional marriage, so we are not going to have him speak to our students. Others in the community suggested that they're not going to allow this event to happen because it is political. Now, I want to touch on this objection for a little bit because we've been seeing a lot of activists being faced with this objection that you can't hold your events, you can't hold your activities because your organization or what you're trying to do is somehow political. If you are trying to organize or promote conservatism, if you're trying to promote the ideas of limited government, individual freedom, that is not being political. You are being, that's educational. You're trying to educate other students at your school about the ideas that you believe in. What these schools are trying to do, what the administrators are trying to do with this objection is they're trying to use, you know, IRS regulations to try and intimidate you. So don't fall for it. Just like the environmental club or the social justice club at your school has the right to go around and talk about their ideas and why we need to stop global warming, whether you agree with that or not, you have just as much right as they do to talk about your ideas. So don't let them tell you that you can't organize, you can't hold your events on campus, so don't fall for that objection. Now, going back to this specific example, the YAF chapter there wasn't about to let their event be canceled. So they worked with the foundation, and we got the story out to on a national level. The Washington Times, USA Today, the AP, Fox News all picked up on the story. And not shockingly, after all these stories came out, the school backed off, and they allowed the event to continue. And in the end, we had Rick Santorum speak to 1,300 high school students. He talked about his ideas, and it was a real great event for that chapter. Again, so don't ever back down and don't let the administrators at your school push you around. However, I think what we can learn from these, you know, attacks on free expression on your campuses and from the attacks of trying to stop you guys from organizing your activities is I think it really just underscores how desperate and determined, I guess, the left is to try and stop your events from happening and just to maintain their monopoly. I mean, obviously, they're not for, you know, balance or diversity or open discussion. They're for intimidation and indoctrination. And despite having control of the White House, the Senate, college, most college and high schools, there are leftist activists and administrators out there who somehow feel threatened by the fact that there are students like you who simply just want to go out and promote conservative ideas at your school. On some college campuses, it's so bad that just the mere presence of conservatives is like a threat to like liberal sensibilities on those campuses. And I always felt the leftist reaction to conservative activity to be kind of strange. I mean, I always felt the left's response to conservative activity should be, you know, go ahead. you know, bring in your one conservative speaker, organize your one conservative club. We know that, you know, our ideas can withstand anything that your little club has to offer. But obviously, that's not the left's response. They try and undermine you with dirty tricks and bureaucratic maneuvers and so on. And certainly, these activities aren't limited to college campuses. The same methods that the left first uses on college campuses is then applied on a national level. And basically, all of our universities are training grounds for liberal activists to then take those tactics to the national level. I mean, we see it happen all the time. And even though there have been times, too, that the left has seemingly been defeated, they've always pressed forward with their ideas. So, for example, let's look after the 2000 and 2004 presidential elections. I mean, the left could have just given up. They could have said, we can't beat President Bush. We're going to pack it in and go do something else. But, of course, they didn't do that. They relentlessly attacked our ideas. They relentlessly attacked our leaders. And they were able to convince the American people that George W. Bush's ideas really hurt this country. Let's go forward and look at the 2010 midterm elections. There was a huge conservative victory. And there was a lot of people out there saying that there was no way that, you know, Barack Obama could be reelected in 2012. Well, obviously that didn't happen. And even right now, you know, things aren't looking good, at least as far as it's polling. But, you know, has Barack Obama at during any of these times where his polling and his numbers aren't that high, has he ever considered to implement any conservative ideas? Has he talked with any conservative leaders, really? No, he could care less. So we have to take the same approach. We cannot be complacent and adopt a defeatist attitude. Someone said, I'm not sure who it was, Andrew Breitbart or someone like that, but someone said that basically what happens with the conservatives is that after the elections, we go home, yet the left keeps fighting. So we can't do that any longer. And I know some of you are certainly don't fall into that category. But if honestly, if you guys want to be a leader in the future, if you want to run for Congress later in your life, there's really no better time than now than to determine and develop your own activist mentality. Because obviously the left is going to be out there and ready to go after you and to attack you. And honestly, now is the best time to try and test that out. Obviously, we've seen that with the leftists out there basically trying to undermine conservative programs and conservative events. But rarely do we as conservatives do this. We should be going to events featuring liberal speakers and asking tough questions. We shouldn't be as disruptive as the other side. We shouldn't be throwing bricks through windows, but we should be there to challenge their ideas head on. Now, I know for some of you that can be truly an intimidating thought. But what you need to remember is that you may not represent the majority of opinion on campus, but you do represent the majority of opinion in society at large. And basically, you need to see your role as reminding the campus community that there is like a real world outside the campus boundaries that feels that their value system is ludicrous. You know, you kind of need to see yourselves as like the sane ones in the asylum. And you also need to remember there's a lot of students at each and every one of your schools who really doesn't pay attention to this stuff. They don't know. They're just monitored. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know about these ideas. However, if the incoming freshman class at your school goes through the next 4 years without ever hearing any conservative ideas, they can become liberal by osmosis. So what you all need to do, I know some of you are active, but for those of you who are not, I definitely encourage you to step up. And if you do now, do so now, you can have a tremendous impact even on the most liberal college campuses. But the key to your success is to really boldly advance your ideas. The key is not to kind of get along with the other side or, God forbid, to try and appease them. Your goal is to try and advance your ideas in a bold manner. Now, unfortunately, during my time at the foundation, I've seen or noticed that our side, our activists, tend to follow one of two approaches when trying to organize their activities. On the one hand, there are students who follow what I call passive activism. Now, what's this? It kind of sounds like an oxymoron. Well, basically, these students, yes, they're active and they're in a club, but a lot of the club's activities focus exclusively on doing things like having social events, maybe having like a voter registration drive, maybe like, you know, playing touch football with the college gyms or whatever. And, you know, you can do these events and you can have that as part of your club. But these events, in and of themselves, do very little to actually promote your ideas to other students on those campuses. It's almost as if these groups have adopted a live and let live philosophy. In other words, as long as the left never directly comes after their club, they'll leave the left alone. But in turn, by doing that, the other side gets all they want. They get all the funding they want, all the programs they want, and so on. Well, on the other hand, there are those of you in this room who follow what I call bold activism, and that some of you make a point to promote conservatism each week, whether that's through posting flyers, bringing speakers in, tweeting, blogging, whatever it may be. And it's the students that follow this more bolder style of activism that have a much broader impact than those that follow the passive approach. And I always like to compare these two approaches of campus activism back to how two past Republican presidents dealt with the former Soviet Union. On the one hand, of course, if you remember your history, there's a president like Richard Nixon. And if you remember his policy towards the Soviets, his philosophy was to taunt. He wanted to get along with them. He wanted to maintain the status quo. Even though the Soviets were determined to destroy our way of life, he wanted to get along with them. And it was because of this policy that he followed, along with Presidents Ford and Carter, that we slowly saw communism gaining ground and freedom losing ground. Well, on the other hand, of course, we know there's a president like Ronald Reagan. Reagan, of course, made a point to confront and defeat the Soviets. He called them an evil empire. He challenged Gorbachev to tear down the Berlin Wall. And it was because of President Reagan's confrontational approach that he's often credited with ending the Cold War. Well, as you, as conservative activists, want to follow what I call the Ronald Reagan model of campus activism, and that you want to follow the bold approach that Ronald Reagan took to defeating the Soviets, to potentially using that same approach to defeating the left on your college campuses. Now, how do you do this? Well, first of all, you got to join a conservative club. And I want to emphasize that Young America's Foundation works with any conservative club that is out there on any college campus. So, for example, we work with the Amherst CRs this year to bring in Newt Gingrich and Dinesh D'Souza. We work with anyone. However, if you are at a school that does not have any sort of conservative organization, I certainly encourage you to start a Young Americans for Freedom chapter. And we'll work very closely with you to get your chapter up and running and give you the resources necessary to make an impact. However, having a club is very important. It gives you a vehicle to promote your ideas. It gives you a way to attract other students. And if you want to have activities on your campus and you need to go to your university to bring in a speaker or do anything, you know, it's very unlikely that your school is going to give you, say, thousands of dollars to put in your personal bank account to bring in someone like Newt Gingrich at your school. So you have to be part of a conservative organization. Now, beyond that, one of the most basic problems that a lot of groups face, whether they've been around for 2 months or 2 years, is just really figuring out how do they maintain interest in their organization and how do they just build their membership. Well, following the Reagan model will help you solve this problem. Because a lot of the basic issues about maintaining their membership all boils down to how often do other students see your club out there at your schools actually doing things? You know, do you have a visible presence? A lot of students aren't going to be encouraged to join a group that they perceive that just doesn't do anything. Like, why should they bother? So, for example, we basically went back this spring and we put together a poll, and we polled a lot of students out and around. It was a scientific poll, and we looked specifically at students that were conservative yet weren't yet active at their schools. And what we tried to do is find out how do we get these students who were conservative and how do we figure out what are their hesitations to join a conservative group at their respective universities. And what we found out was pretty interesting. We found out, one, that first, 70% didn't care if the club was respected by the faculty, so that wasn't a big deal to students. 64% said they were willing to join a group that focuses on ideas that they cared about. So there are conservative students that want to join an organization. But what's really strange is that, or curious, is that their main hesitation is that they didn't know anyone else involved. And despite this being the era of like Facebook and Snapchat and Tumblr and whatever, students seem to want to have that personal connection with you and your organization before they will join. So, for example, at a previous event, I was talking to Savannah at Hillsdale, and, you know, why did she choose to join the YAF chapter there? And she was kind of saying, well, I was hesitant at first, and I'm paraphrasing, I think, like, she was nervous that it would just be a big click, and they wouldn't talk to her and whatever. And so, like, you know, that's, they weren't like that, of course, but that was a hesitation. At Penn State, I was talking to the Penn State YAFers last night. And Taylor was talking about when she first came to the first meeting, you know, she was like, well, I'm going to bring my friend, my roommate, Annalise, or Ace, as she likes to be called, I think. And she was saying, like, you know, I had no interest in politics before that meeting, but I got involved. Now she's here at this conference, and she's really excited about the conservative movement. And lastly, yeah. Lastly, at John DeJacoby School, Highland High School, I was talking to the current vice chair of his old YAF chapter. And she was telling me, her name is Grace, she was telling me that, like, yeah, you know, I was thinking about joining the club, you know, but I was thinking about it for months. But it wasn't until I saw the YAF chapter, I saw John and Julia and the other members of his group out there actually on the campus so I could actually go and talk, get to know them, and become comfortable with them. So, I mean, again, you can't overlook this physical presence that your club has. That's very important to attracting members to your organization. So along with following the Reagan model, I think every organization should have two basic goals, a weekly goal and an organizational goal. And your weekly goal, I think, should be is to have some way to promote conservatism. Now, you can do this in one of two ways. One, you can simply go out and just attack the left. And you can certainly have a lot of fun with this. There's a lot of opportunities to do so. You can go to like an earth fair or an environmental fair, get your club together and scream obnoxious slogans like burn the rainforest and shoot the manatees and things like that. And, you know, infuriate everybody like all over the place. And you can have a lot of fun potentially. But you're actually probably not going to bring a lot of people to our side. And I'm not actually suggesting you do that, although it could be fun. What you should do instead is really focus on promoting your ideas. Again, go back and look at President Reagan. When he was president, what he did, he just didn't go out and attack every left-wing program. What he did was he identified their greatest weakness. And specifically with the Soviets, he discovered that it was the Berlin Wall that was their greatest weakness, and he, of course, exploited it. So you want to do the same thing at your school. But typically, it's very rare that attacking the left will get you very far. And in most cases, it's much better to start your own programs, take the offensive, as they say, and really force the left to respond to you. And I'll give you some specific examples in a minute. That'll bring you, and the second goal you should follow, of course, is your organizational goal. And that is you want your organization to be the most prominent club on campus. Not the most prominent conservative club, the most prominent club, period. You want to get to the point that whenever a teacher, the president of the school, or a local newspaper reporter, you know, say that reporter is running a story on, you know, what young conservatives believe, you know, you want that reporter to automatically think of you and your organization. But the only way you get to that point of being known by everyone, by being known as the young conservative source in your community and on your campus, is by focusing on your weekly goal. Because the weekly goal shows you that your club is out there, you're active, you're serious and effective at promoting conservatism at your school. Now, when I say you want to promote conservatism each week, I'm not suggesting you have to go out and hold a protest all the time or something like that. That's totally not necessary. Even doing something simple, like posting up a flyer, can be tremendously effective. And I want to touch on an example that one of your fellow conference attendees did a few years ago. And this example basically happened a few years ago, if you remember, when Rush Limbaugh called Sandra Fluke a slut, and there was like this huge media firestorm about it. And, you know, despite the fact that, you know, conservative women leaders have been called really nasty names by other leftists, much nastier things, yet the media never said anything about it. Well, one of your fellow college attendees wanted to kind of point out this hypocrisy. And so Grant Strobel over here, he wanted to make this hypocrisy known. Now, he could have responded and reacted in any number of ways when he was at his school. He could have, you know, put out a frustrated tweet, could have wrote a blog, could have put out an op-ed in the campus paper, you know, but instead he decided to put together some flyers, which basically said, we need to respect all women. And here are the flyers that Grant designed to put up for his chapter. It features a number of conservative women leaders and kind of highlighting some of the nasty things that the left has called conservative women and how we need to respect them as well, and kind of point out the hypocrisy. Of course, when Grant went to put up these flyers at his school, the school said, no, you're not doing that. Despite the fact, of course, I'm sure you can guess, that many liberal themed posters have been put up with no problem whatsoever. So Grant wasn't gonna let this go unchallenged. And we learned of this objection by the school when Grant happened to be out at the Reagan Ranch with Alex Marlowe from Breitbart. And by working together with Alex, we got his story up on the front page of Breitbart, caused a huge controversy. It definitely spread. Daily Caller picked up on it, Yahoo News. It spread to his community. And the school newspaper also wrote an article in support of Grant and his GF chapter and putting up these flyers. And because of the controversy that Grant created, and by standing up for his free speech rights, later that school year, the principal resigned his position, and the flyers were eventually allowed to go up on campus. So good job, Grant. So again, you don't have to have huge events. Small, simple activities like posting flyers can be tremendously effective. And they're a way to make your other students and involve your other members of your club and make them feel welcome. Like, I'll never forget my first meeting with my YAF chapter at Penn State. I went there, like, not really thinking about, I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know anyone there. I went to the meeting. They talked about bringing in speakers and going to conferences. I'm like, whatever, we'll see. But after the meeting, they approached me and they said, hey, do you want to help us hang up flyers? And I was like, yeah, that sounds like fun. Now, obviously, to many of you, hanging up a flyer is like, yeah, whatever, no big deal. But to me, as that new member at the time, I was like, wow, I'm actually doing something to promote conservatism. And so that made me, you know, I was like, wow, I want to keep doing this. So again, don't ever underestimate smaller, simple activities. This flyer example also brings me to another point I want to touch on. And that is, before you organize any activity at your school, before you bring in any speaker, first sit down and think through whether the speaker's topic or the issue you want to focus on actually matters to other students at your school. For example, you know, you want to avoid getting caught in the trap of focusing on an issue that, say, you may personally love. Like, it's kind of silly, like, for example, like, you may personally love talking about Medicare or transportation funding or whatever. And obviously, if you did that and had events on those topics, no one would show up. I mean, who wants to go to an event on transportation funding? But anyhow, but in addition to that, say, for example, taxes. A lot of conservatives on college campuses want to talk about why taxes should be low and why that's important and helps the economy and so on, helps you get a job. But, you know, most students don't work that much and they don't pay a lot of taxes. So in most cases, taxes hasn't been a successful issue. You have to make it relevant to other students. You want to think about what are the issues at your each of your schools that will resonate with other students on your campus. And your goal with all of your programs is to reach the broadest possible audience. So in other words, your goal is not just to reach the radical left at your school. I mean, they're probably just gonna come and try and disrupt your event anyways or protest it. Your goal is not just to have the conservatives there because they kind of agree with you. Your goal is to get that average moderate student who all he does after class is goes back to his dorm room, gets on his my computer or whatever and plays like Call of Duty multiplayer for 10 hours a day or watches YouTube videos of some guy singing Let It Go and 21 Disney character voices or whatever it may be. Your goal is to actually get these people to leave their rooms and go interact with like live human beings. So you have to think through how you're gonna make your events compelling. Lastly, I wanna talk about one final strategic point. And that is just as important about thinking through the speakers you're going to invite and also thinking through what issues you're going to touch on but also think through the terms you're going to use. You know, what terms are you going to use to help define your issue? Maybe thinking, well, who cares? What makes it different? What's the difference if what terms I use to talk about conservative ideas? Well, if you pick the wrong words, it'll make your job much more difficult. Let me give you an example. Last year, the foundation polled students across the country on their views on topics of based around free enterprise. You know, do they like free enterprise? What do they think of capitalism? And so on. And the good news from the poll is that, yes, students don't want more government involvement in their lives. And they want the government to spend less. That's great. However, they had very specific opinions about terms that we use to present our ideas on the free market, basically. And I want to focus on three terms that conservatives tend to use when promoting our ideas. And students from this poll certainly had very strong opinions on these three terms and had certainly different favorability ratings, as they were called. As far as entrepreneurship, students had a 66% favorability rating towards entrepreneurship. On the free market, they had a 44% favorability rating towards capitalism. Capitalism only had a 33% favorability rating. So if you want to talk about the free market on your campus or organize events around these ideas, I would certainly encourage you, of course, to use the terms like entrepreneurship or free market over capitalism. Now, I know a lot of conservatives, a lot of libertarians like to talk about and use the word capitalism. Steve Forbes has a book on how capitalism will save us. But, you know, again, according to these polls, we were much better off using terms like entrepreneurship or free market over the term capitalism. Certainly, Young America's Foundation has a lot of resources available to you all to help you kind of guide you through this. We have two books that we are happy to provide to you for free, and that is our Conservative Guide to Campus Activism and our Campus Conservative Battle Plan. Let me kind of differentiate these two. The Activism Guide basically gives you general broad advice on how to start a club, how to avoid activist traps, how to promote your organization, and so on. What the battle plan does is it gives you specific activities that you can organize each month of the school year. We also provide a number of free materials that you guys can download right from our website and distribute, or we're happy to mail you just a box of stuff that you can use and hand out at recruitment fairs. Now what I want to do just quickly is kind of walk you through the fall semester and kind of highlight some specific activities that every single one of you can organize on your college campuses. For September, of course, is the 9/11 Never Forget Project. And this is a program that we started in 2003 when we noticed that a lot of schools were basically ignoring the anniversary of 9/11. Here it was the most monumental event in recent American history, and most schools are pretty much ignoring it the day. So we created this program to help you guys encourage your school to remember the anniversary properly. And the main point of the Never Forget Project is the flag memorial. And basically, it's a memorial of about 2,977 flags to represent each person killed in the terrorist attacks. And it's a very strong reminder of how our country was impacted on that day. Young America's Foundation works with a flag distributor to help you get very affordable flags. We do provide financial assistance, and we also provide you with other guidance to help make your event successful. So how many of you in here have organized this before? Great. Well, we're certainly happy to help many more of you do the same, and please don't hesitate to call on us to help you put this together. Now, let's move to October. Many of you know who this guy is, right? Who is he? Che Guevara. Yeah, but a lot of your classmates have no idea. They just think he was a nice poet who rode around on a motorcycle and wrote poetry or whatever. They don't know that he was a thug, basically. They don't know that he killed children in his guerrilla camps for simply being accused of stealing food. They don't know that, for example, that he felt the solution to the world's problems could be found behind the Iron Curtain, the same Iron Curtain that murdered 100 million people. So what we decided to do was to take the day that he was executed in Bolivia, and we called that day No More Che Day. And so we we created Nomura Chede to help you guys educate your fellow students on who this guy really was. So, for example, we have some flyers on our website you can download that have quotes from Che talking about how much he likes to kill people. We have our Victims of Che Guevara poster that we can send you for free. And it's basically, I don't know if you can tell, it's a photo mosaic, basically using images of people who were murdered by Che and the Cuban regime. And again, it's a great way to show people, show other students at your school who this guy truly was. Now let's move on to November, and this is Freedom Week. And as you all know, the left loves to have their little themed weeks, like Coming Out Week and whatever it is on most college campuses. Well, Freedom Week is a way for you to hold a week-long activity based around ideas that we like. So Freedom Week celebrates two basic events. It celebrates the anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall and Veterans Day. And both of these events slash holidays occur during the same week, and you can organize a lot of events around this time. And this year is actually the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. So what we try and do, yes, we should definitely celebrate that. We try and provide you again with a lot of free materials like these. A lot of the left on campus don't like the posters that we hand out telling about how many murders have been committed by progressive regimes. We encourage you guys to build and then tear down a mock Berlin Wall. And the idea about tearing them down the Berlin Wall or mock Berlin Wall is not just to recognize the anniversary, which you kind of want to do, but it's also a way to remind folks that even though these ideas have failed, there are others in our country who think, hey, we should actually do this again. And so by tearing down the Berlin Wall, it's a way to remind folks that these ideas have failed and we shouldn't embrace them. We also have done our GPA redistribution petition. This is a great way to help make taxes relevant. And then lastly, we have our lecture program. And let me emphasize that bringing in a big name speaker can be one of the best events that you can do during your time on your college campus. There's nothing better than bringing in someone like a Newt Gingrich or an Ann Coulter or a John Stossel or Walter Williams to talk directly to hundreds, if not thousands, of students at your school about conservative ideas. So instead of going through like the left-wing filter of your professors or the media, they'll get to hear your ideas directly from one of the superstars in the conservative movement. And one of the best parts about bringing in a speaker is the live interaction or the drama that goes on, especially during the Q&A section of the event. Like, there is nothing better than during the Q&A and some like arrogant liberal professor gets up and asks what they think is like a tough question to like Newt Gingrich, and he like tears down their arguments in front of like thousands of people. I mean, it is just awesome. Like, it is something you have to witness. So I would certainly encourage you guys to bring in a speaker, and we'll be happy to help you with both financial and logistical assistance. I just want to conclude that really now is the time to be an activist. You guys have been a great group. We love to continue to help you make a difference on your campus. And let me emphasize that when you look back on your time as an activist, once you graduate college, it's going to be your time as an activist that you'll cherish and remember. It's not going to be your classes, and it's not going to be your teachers. And I know every single one of you out there is sitting there thinking, oh, I can remember that teacher and that class and blah, blah, blah. Well, for those who have graduated and several years have gone by, all that stuff fades. Like for me, I can't remember most of my classes. I can't remember most of my teachers' names. But what I remember, as if it happened yesterday, is my time as an activist. And, you know, you'll have opportunities as an activist that you won't have otherwise. For example, one of my favorite stories is I worked with the College Republicans at Canisius College in Buffalo, New York, and they were able to bring in the actor Ben Stein from Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And yeah, he's good. And so he had a great event, had a lot of people there, but they found out that Ben Stein had never seen Niagara Falls. And so the next day, the College Republicans took Ben Stein to see Niagara Falls, and they got to see Ben Stein's typical reaction, which was just like the, wow, you know? Like. So those are experiences you're not going to have otherwise. And I just want to finally emphasize that just a little bit of activism can have a huge impact. And I have proof. What I have here in my hand is an email from a leftist to his other leftist buddies at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And I want to read this email to you that showcased the impact that conservative activity can have. Now, before I read this, I just want to set up what was going on at the University of California, Santa Barbara at the time. Before this email went out, the College Republicans on campus simply brought in one conservative speaker, an Oliver North, all right? And they were about to bring in a second conservative speaker, Ward Connerly, to talk about ending racial preferences. So let me read what this one liberal student was writing to their liberal friends. She says, "Hey, I appreciate that we want to get together and welcome Uncle Ward onto our campus. However, I personally do not see the issue being about Ward Connerly. It is not an accident that Oliver North came to our campus last quarter, nor is puppet Connerly's visit this quarter a coincidence. Someone spent time and money bringing them into our campus. This weekend, the College Republicans have sponsored Young America's Foundation to hold a training on right-wing campus government insurgency. This is for real. There is a growing conservative movement on this campus." Now, give me a break. Like, honestly, like, UCSB is one of the most liberal schools in the country. There are liberal events going on every day on that campus. Liberal speakers coming in all the time. Yet the conservatives at that school can bring in two speakers, just two, and the left is freaking out about it. Just shows you the impact you can have. So please, take advantage of it. We'll be happy to help you. Thank you very much. We're really late today, and I'm sorry about the delay. We'll just take one quick question.
Hi, I'm Erin Krajewski. I'm a junior at Ave Maria University.
Yeah.
And my question actually has to do with my school.
Yeah.
We're 1,000 students.
Yes.
And we're probably 98% conservatives, including professors in that. I'm president of College Republicans down there. And it's kind of hard. There's a complacency now because of where we are. I mean, we're surrounded by Naples, which is a lot of Republicans, too. Our entire county was, like, the only one in Southwest Florida that went Republican last election. So I was wondering if you have any advice, especially for people who go to, like, smaller conservative colleges, on what they can do to get people involved or excited about the conservative movement when they kind of already agree with what you're doing.
Sure. I would suggest what we've seen from the chapters at Hillsdale and at Liberty is that the same principles of activism, the same ideas of building your presence and always being out there still stand true. So, for example, the Hillsdale YAF chapter, they're having events all the time. They're had, like, for Constitution Day, one of my favorite ideas they did, instead of just handing out constitutions, they did that, but they also made these little, like, apple pie cupcake things. Anyway, but it made it interesting and made it fun, but they're always out there doing things. They have a very active Facebook page. They're bringing in speakers. So it's the same principles. It's a very conservative campus, but they were recognized last year as the best group on campus. And it was because that they were active and they were doing the same things. So I would encourage you to follow the same model. It's about just being visible, being present, and just showing your club is out there and active. So, all right, thank you guys.